Just a quick introduction about me. I'm Guruprasad. I work for Moonfrog as an architect, and I've been there for the last 1 year. And my background has been pretty much on things like distributed systems and stuff like that. This is the first year that I have been working with Moonfrog, and this is my first experience into gaming. And most of the learnings that we are going to be talking about today is going to be around those things, right? So Arun is going to be helping me with the workshop.
So I am Arun. I am working in Moonfrog Labs, and I am a client-side programmer. I started my career from 2005, and love to work on graphics. And yeah, that's it. I will walk you through the workshop later. He will continue from here. Thank you.
So as you see, both of us come with a very different set of experiences. So we should be able to cover a lot of your questions. So hopefully we can make this interactive. That said, what are we going to be doing for the next 1.5 hours, right? So the goal would be that this is supposed to have been a workshop. So I think we can actually make it into a workshop, but we at least want to get a multiplayer game out today in front of you working. So Arun is going to be walking you through that workshop, and if you have your laptops, then I would really encourage you to kind of follow along. We can actually make it very interactive. If not, you can just try to remember how much ever you can from here, right? But that's only a part of it. We don't want to stop here. What we want to do is try to understand different challenges that you will probably encounter when you're building a really full-fledged real-time simulation multiplayer game, right? So that's not very evident when you start off. So we will also see that we'll take a slightly complex use case and try to build a simpler case, and then as we make that use case a little bit more complicated, how things break apart, right? So we want to do that. We want to spend more time on this aspect of understanding what different challenges that you will encounter. So this is more of preempting you. If you end up in a journey of trying to build a multiplayer game, you are aware of these challenges, and then you know what to look for in the game, in the Google or whatever, right? We also will explore certain solutions that we at least were able to use for some of these challenges, and it worked well for us in some cases, and some cases not so good. We'll describe those trade-offs. And as anything with computer science, there is no right solution or wrong solution. It's extremely contextual. Hopefully, you'll be able to take the learnings and apply it on your own context and scenario, right? So this is if you really want to follow along. I don't see a lot of people with laptops. So if you had, for example, these would be the technologies that you would want to have. So Unity is what we are doing the workshop on. And to quickly get a multiplayer thing working, we are using Photon. But as you'll see, as we progress towards the later part of the workshop, things might not be that great on Photon out of the box. You either need to really fine-tune things, or you need to build your own capabilities. And that's where Golang comes in, where we built our own server to support the multiplayer use cases that we had. And that's the cases that we'll talk about. So this is where the code is hosted. You guys can take a look either now or later. And pretty much download most of what we are going to be talking about is hosted there, including the PPT and the source code, right? So the use case that we selected for today, right? So this is a simple game. It's ping pong, right? So there's a ball and two players playing, except that it's multiplayer, right? So over the internet is what we are talking about here. So these two players are essentially passing the ball to each other, and if someone misses, then there's a score for the other player, right? This is the ideal situation that we want to be in, where this is working extremely smoothly for both the players. The really tricky part here is that there is a lot of physics-y stuff getting involved here. The ball is bouncing around, the ball is ricocheting off the players. And also, there are two different players controlling the same ball, right? So you will see this can get a little complex. I don't want to get into the complexities right now. We will build up to that. So that said, what we want to do the workshop for is a little simplistic one. As I said, the shared ball actually makes it complex. So for the workshop, what we will do is we'll add a barrier, right? So there is a barrier there. Now the two players are actually playing with their own ball, right? But you're able to see what the other player is doing. And if he misses the ball, you get a score. Right? So this is a more simplistic version that we will be able to build out in the next 20 minutes. And then try to head our way to building the actual game. Which was, so with the workshop, we will be trying to touch upon these things where we will set up the basic Photon capabilities. Yeah, we'll be setting up basic Photon capabilities. We'll also set up, we'll also see how we are synchronizing the actual ball movement across the screens. We'll also kind of touch upon a little bit about physics, because that will be useful for the rest of our discussion, right?
Hello guys. So I hope actually most of you, many of you are working on a Unity, and this couple of, after the few slides, I will be explaining you about the workshop details and how it can be done on Unity. Okay, so we already actually lost few minutes at the beginning. So actually I am moving forward with the workshop. Okay, so first and foremost thing is, first I set up Photon. So I hope actually, how many of you know about Photon plugin? Okay, so yeah, quite a bit. Yeah, cool. And I hope actually Photon uses certain technology to synchronize over the network, right? And certain technologies it is being used. So we will go through it and we will see actually what are the problems involved in those plugins. It's not like actually their limitation, but there are certain things which we need to explain, which we want to explain to you guys. I have a project which I already developed. Okay, so you can go through that one, which if you are interested in going through it, GitHub link. Okay, so there are actually some of these projects related stuff I have explained. And if you go through these particular details, that is in this PDF detail, you can actually, I am going through these steps. So you can actually, if you want to try out, actually you can try out things. I don't want to do any Unity analytics here. Okay, create the project. So now we have a sample scene. We don't want this particular scene for our game. We have actually two scenes. That is, one is the launcher scene and the other one is the game scene. Okay, so first thing actually, we will set up the launcher scene for us. Okay, so if you go through that the GitHub link, I have given two assets, that is actually Sprite and Scripts folder. So this I am using for now. I don't want to do it everything over here. So it contains the Photon's initialization and certain stuff. It will throw certain errors, and because Photon is not yet there. So those who don't know about Photon, so Photon is the plugin which we use for networking. Okay, and there are other plugins as well. We are comfortable with Photon, and so we tried it in Photon, and it was very easy to set up. So go to the asset store, search for the free Photon plugin, that is actually 1, 2 free, and click on it. We don't want the demos. So I'm using my own registration code for now. So when you set up the Photon, you have to actually register your app in the Photon website. So there you will get that particular app ID for your, I have created for this particular GDC workshop, and I'm copying it for now. Used it for my project. So close it, and yeah, that's it. The Photon plugin is now ready for your game. In the scripts, I have four scripts. That is, one is the launcher, which actually initializes the Photon and actually connects to the network for you. And the game scene, which initializes your game scene, and the rigid body is your player. And the two thing is the player, the two strikers, that is the players, and they have their own balls. They are using their own rigid bodies for now. Create an empty object for our launcher. That's launcher, and add our launcher script. Where is it? Okay, so there's something. So we are just adding the launcher script to that Unity object. Okay, I will go through the code after the setup, initial setup. I will try our first whether the connection is happening or not. So it is trying to connect. Yeah. So the game scene is not yet been created, set up. So it given that error. Okay, so here is your launcher script. Connects at this beginning. And if there is any room available, it will try to, we are generating a random room here. So it tries for it. And the max player per room is 2. Okay. And Yeah, it's a pretty much, you can go through the Photon setup, I mean, their tutorial, and go through it completely. So we are not worried about this particular setup. We are worried about the networking part later. Okay. The next thing is we have to set up our game scene. So new scene. This is our game scene, and we create our parts, so your text. So in the final version, we will explain the setup and all stuff. So if you guys are interested, go to that particular PDF and go for how it is being set up kind of things. So this is the final game, okay, which we developed in this, that one. The only things I couldn't able to actually edit the particular viewport. So here, even if you see this one, I cannot even move this one. So that's it's pretty much hard for me to go through the steps. Okay, so here we have the striker, and if I used my second laptop, you can see the second player over here. Okay, and I will try to show you guys that particular thing. So that's very important for this particular workshop to go further. So this is the one. So I played it with this particular laptop. Okay, and it is being connected to that laptop. Now you can clearly see. Okay, now so this is the workshop about. He will be explaining about what's the problem in this one, and why we have actually certain different solutions for those problems.
So I hope you guys followed. I know it was extremely choppy over because of a lot of issues with the projections and stuff. But that shouldn't really matter to us. I think if you follow along the GitHub link, you should be able to definitely set up the game. What we actually want to spend now time on is this aspect. So this is the game we ended up with, right? Let's just focus on the green ball for now, right? So this is my local player. I'm playing on my local device, and the green that side is on the remote device where he's seeing what's happening on the green player side, right? And it's alternate for the red player. Like red player is getting control from there, and he's seeing what the red player is doing, right? So the problem that we are trying to see is look at the way the green ball moves on the other side for him. Here it's extremely smooth, right? You see the ball bouncing, there is gravity, there is physics, everything working perfectly fine. But on the other side, I'm playing it again, the ball is kind of flying around. Right? You guys are able to make that out, right? It's not so smooth. So this is the first problem that you will hit, like if you just plug and play Photon, and if your game is that real-time simulation sort of a thing, this is the first problem that you will hit, right? So essentially, we want to kind of try to understand what's happening in that problem. Like, why is that ball floating around so much, right? There are two problem areas, and this is where we start to make the use case a little bit more complex. But first, we'll solve the problems that is there in this use case. There are essentially two problems. There is latency, which is the time taken for data to get transferred from one device to another device. And there is going to be an inherent latency that you can't really get rid of, right? There is something called position sync that we are talking about, the way we synchronize the data across the device. Assume there is latency, but what do we do? How do we share data across device, and how does each device kind of simulate the animation?
We'll talk about both the problems one by one.
Latency is what the first thing that we want to understand a little better. What does latency mean? There tends to be a lot of confusion between latency and bandwidth and stuff like that.
Just want to clear that upfront. Latency and bandwidth, they do impact each other, but they're quite different things, right? So if you take a highway, the number of lanes on the highway is essentially the bandwidth of that highway. If there's a 7-lane or 8-lane, that's the bandwidth of that highway. How fast can the car go on that highway? That is the latency of the whole pipeline, right? If the car can go at 100 miles per hour, that's the latency. That does not mean to say that they are completely independent. They're actually very dependent on each other. So assume there is a traffic jam on the highway, even if it's a 100 mile per hour car, it's probably moving at 5 miles per hour. So these are the two things that will actually play significantly when you're building your multiplayer games across the internet. There's obviously a lot of other things that play into it, like congestion and stuff, but they kind of fall into the bucket of bandwidth, right?
So the point here that we are trying to kind of address here is that you can't really solve for latency as per, you can't really make latency as zero, right? We agree that we can't make latency as zero. So latency by nature is kind of limited by the speed of light. That's the way the signals are traveling. But there's also all of these hops and bandwidth constraints that it needs to deal with. So typically on the internet, you will need to kind of design your game for about 100 to 150 ms kind of a latency for each packet to get traveled. How do you make these decisions in the right way so that you kind of contain the latency to these numbers? So typically you will make this decision first. What is the protocol that you want to use, right? There are two different network protocols, TCP and UDP. So what do they mean? Any of you can read that and you get that joke, you understand what is UDP, right? So essentially what it is saying is UDP is an unreliable protocol, which means that it is like a fire and forget. It's going to send data across to the other person or multicast it to multiple people. And it's not really worried about whether the packet actually reaches there or not. And there are a lot of good use cases where this makes a total sense, right? Just think of video streaming and stuff like that. It's okay to for a couple of pixels to get lost as long as the error rate is under control. UDP still works in those kind of control. And this is UDP is what is used in those sort of scenarios of video buffering and stuff. TCP on the other hand is an extremely reliable protocol. It does a lot of acknowledgement based handshake and every packet is acknowledged. There's a lot of flow control. It does not let your network get choked. All that actually comes with a cost. Because that is essentially the latency of the thing, and latency and the bandwidth that TCP actually inherits, right? So UDP, for example, is an extremely fast protocol. You are not bounded by congestions and stuff like that, but it gives you that advantage of speed, right? And most typical than not, you will need that. If you're really serious about building your multiplayer game with a really awesome experience, you will probably want to optimize for UDP, though it means that you need to build a lot of complexity around the protocol of error handling, how much error are you okay with and not okay with. But it is something definitely that you need to consider. However, it might be easier for you to get started with TCP. So it depends on what stage of the development you are in, right? This is another typical decision that you tend to make. So P2P is like, these are devices, and peer-to-peer is essentially all of these devices are connected to each other and are multicasting and talking to each other. There's another model where there's a common relay server, where all of these servers are essentially relaying their data to this central server, and then this central server is actually acting as an orchestrator to do the data transfer, right? So there are advantages and disadvantages again here for both. Most real-time serious multiplayer games there out there would be built on the server architecture, client-server architecture, primarily because this is subject to a lot of devices being kind of reliable and stuff like that. So even here, you will elect somebody as a master, in the sense one guy is actually orchestrating the actual positions and the rules of the game and stuff like that. But that is kind of assuming that this device is going to be reliable if I elect this as a thing. And if this device goes out of your network, then you need to re-elect and stuff. There are complexities in handling edge cases in this, but it's quicker to get started because of plugins like Photon, which supports this out of the box. As you get more into your development cycle, you would probably want to kind of switch to a client-server model, which is going to be more reliable. Your systems are going to be kind of little bit more resilient to cheating and stuff like that, because most of your logic is going to be on the server, and all of that devices are essentially just orchestrated based on that, right? So mostly you will tend to get towards a client-server architecture as your game use case becomes more serious, right? Again, I just want to reiterate, that this is not going to solve latency problem. These are decisions that you make to reduce your latency concerns and keep it under control. And the number that you should have in mind is potentially about 100 to 150 ms. So the another thing that we are doing there, which was position synchronization, the way we are synchronizing, or at least the way the Photon works out of the box, is kind of explained through this. I don't know if this can't be visible, but I'll explain again. So these are two devices. Just assume there are frames that are playing out in two devices. There's a blue device and the green device. There's obviously this inherent latency. That's why this starts playing a little later than this. So what's happening here is player is at this position, and I'm synchronizing the position. That's why it's called position synchronization, right? So you're synchronizing the XY coordinate and the orientation of that player. Obviously, you're not going to synchronize that at every frame on each device. Potentially at the third frame here, as an example, you're synchronizing again, and at the fifth frame, again, you're synchronizing the XY and the orientation. And this device is essentially receiving that commands and rendering that player in those different positions and orientations. So this is position sync. And what's happening here is, if you just look at this frame now, this is the actual experience of the user on the remote device, right? So you want this to be smooth. So here what's happening is the player is here, the player is still here, suddenly the player moves here, and the player is here and suddenly moves here, but whereas in the first device, it was actually a very smooth movement. How do you solve this? Things like Photon will give you things like interpolation and extrapolation, which is, it's going to play out the animation, it's not going to be really jerky movement, but it's going to play out the animation from here to here. That's not smooth, right? That is exactly what you saw as the broken animation that we saw where the ball is floating around. This animation that plays out is not really physics or anything of that sort. It is just interpolation and extrapolation, right? So it is just going to look like the ball is kind of floating around. This is the first problem that we want to address. So what other models that we can use to kind of synchronize this position? The obvious one that you will tend to go towards is not really synchronizing the positions and letting the other device render the positions of the character. You will want to synchronize. Just coming back to this position sync, I think I missed a use case where it's not that position sync is not going to be applicable for any scenario. This is a use case that I have put here where position sync absolutely works fine. So the thing with position sync is the locations are going to be really accurate. Where the ball was ending up is going to be really accurate. And things like multiplayer car racing is a typical use case for that, where you want the other player's position to be accurate for you, but you really do not worry about whether the player, the car moved in a certain way or not, right? Just want that car to be in the right position as often as possible. So this is a use case, the position sync perfectly works there. And so if you're building something on Photon and this is something your use case kind of resembles to, you should just stick by that. It keeps things extremely simple, right? So position sync, the thing to remember is the locations are accurate. The animations that are going to be playing out are going to be slightly hazy. As I was saying just a little earlier, the solution for this typically that you would explore is state synchronization, in which case you're not really synchronizing the positions, the XY coordinates or the orientation. You are essentially letting the other device know what's happening on this device. Like he started to run. What's the velocity? What's the direction? That's all the other device needs to know. It's going to play out the physics by itself, right? So this is going to look extremely smooth. Like that physics is going to look perfectly fine. So as you see, he's received that direction and he's made that move and he's essentially going to turn command and he turns. So it's pretty smooth there. This is a demo on the state sync. We put state synchronization here. So both the devices, extremely smooth animation. There's no problem. That there is no problem. There's a problem. The ball is not actually ending up in the right position in both the devices, right? So here in state synchronization, the thing to remember is your animations are going to be looking smooth, especially if you have things like physics involved. But there's a high chance, this is obviously a little exaggerated demo, but there's a high chance that your ball is not going to end up in the same location. And that's going to again break the user experience. But that's what's happening here. It's the same, this is my device and this is the remote device. The balls are actually in different positions, but it's okay for our limited version of the game where there was a barrier. I'm not really concerned about the exact position of the other ball as long as it tells me what's the score. I just know he's playing, right? But that's not where we want to head to. This is what we were trying to do, right? And if you extrapolate that same use case here, this is going to be an extremely jarred experience for the user. So he's going to feel extremely cheated. Like if the ball was here, actually ball was somewhere else, that's a totally broken experience. So state synchronization is completely broken here. So to solve that problem, we need to kind of understand what exactly is happening again with state sync. Why is it getting into different positions, right? Again, there are two different reasons for this. I will come to both of the reasons. This is completely not completely visible, but I'll again explain. So just imagine there are two devices and this is the time. So the player is here and the player is here and the ball is essentially on the third location there. So at time t1, this player makes this move, right? So he's pressed this button, for example. He has made this move and the ball is kind of heading towards it. He meets the ball here. But since there's a time delay, obviously this command cannot get translated into the other device like immediately. There is going to be a time delay. So in this other device, the ball is actually moved because the ball was playing by its own physics. The ball is actually moved, but the player is still here. He has not received the command. So the next frame, what happens, obviously again in a little exaggerated demo, but completely explains the point, is that in this device, the ball feels like it has ricocheted and ended up here. Because there was no collision, potentially the ball ends up here or a different position, and the player is here. So this is exactly what was happening there. And one of the players is obviously going to feel cheated. So how do you kind of solve this? So one approach that we have used, and you should definitely explore, and this is a slightly standard approach, which is called deterministic lockstep. This is a slightly dicey thing to achieve because you need to kind of work with some time frame in mind. So that if you remember the latency slide that we talked about, we said that we can't really solve latency completely. Well, that comes in handy here, right? So you need to understand what is the latency that you are going to be working with. You need to measure that constantly. So I'm assuming here, for example, 150 ms is the latency that the network is going to induce. So making that assumption, let's take that same use case. What can I do? The player presses this write button here. I know the command is going to get passed after 150 ms, right? Because of heuristics, or like there are a lot of ways on how you can come to that number and how you can fine tune that number. But assuming that is correct, what I'm going to do in the next step is I'm not going to actually render this, take this input of moving this player immediately. I would rather wait for 150 ms. I would have sent the data there though. So the data would have reached here in 150 ms. So I will only make this move after 150 ms. If everything goes well, on both the devices, the player meets the ball in the same location. Right? Obviously, this is assuming a lot of things. This is assuming that 150 ms is constant, which is going to be tricky, which is why I said arriving at that number is a whole different problem. And technically, you will probably need not have one number. You will probably be constantly monitoring and fine-tuning that number as the game is getting played out. Right? So it's a complex implementation, but just to think of the solution, this is the solution that deterministic lockstep heads towards. So as long as you keep that number as accurate, your ball position is going to be as accurate as possible. So it's not actually going to be accurate in the sense that there are a lot more problems that come apart post this. Arun will walk you through a different set of problems that will happen just after this, which is essentially how physics plays out on different devices, right? So that's a completely different problem already.
Sorry about that workshop. That is a small part of this particular talk, okay? And this is the most important part of this workshop. And this is from here onwards, actually, we are starting to see the solutions, what we applied and how we achieved that particular smooth simulation. Okay, so determinism is a concept which is already there in your computer. So what is determinism? It is for a given input, okay, the output is determined. And since we are using same architecture, so if A plus B equal to C, then in all the devices that will yield the same result. That is determinism, okay? And there is some issues with that determinism as well in our computers, because it's not necessary that all the computers are of same architecture. There are different architectures, there are different OS, and there are different algorithms. Even the floating point representation are different. So there will be slight difference in it. These differences are known as floating point errors. So the key for determinism lies in two things. One is actually we have to somehow make this floating point calculation same across devices. So if you imagine that if you apply a force to a particular rigid body, okay, if all the calculations are same, that means actually it will yield the same result as an output, right? So why it isn't working in the general purpose engines? Because of actually floating point errors. Floating point errors have certain different architectures using different floating point representations. Okay, so we converted that into integer-based calculation. That is known as fixed point math. So if you go through certain, there are different representations for fixed point math. That is 16.16. The old OpenGL uses 16.16, and the Nintendo DS. If you anyone worked on a Nintendo DS, it uses, I think, 27 point something. That kind of 22.10. That's I think, because it uses the 32-bit integer for it's a different version of floating point using integer as the base. Okay, so if it is integer, all the integer calculations are same. Okay, yeah, definitely there is a less in precision, but it is acceptable for our game. And the next thing is actually we will be talking about actually fixing the time intervals. Okay, so that I will go in detail of on the slide when it comes, what it is. It is very important for the game, for any physics, to fix your time intervals. Okay, and of course same input. If you follow these three things, then the determinism is possible in your computer. Okay, so this again actually gives you the same explanation. So how we achieved is by using deterministic physics solver, and the two key thing for this one is fixed point mathematics and the fixed time step. Okay, as long as you can, if you give the same input, it can give you the same output for it. This is one example. Many people might know about Mini Clips 8 Ball Pool game. It is completely written on deterministic physics. The engineer itself actually has written the document for this one. So you can actually go, there is a particular link below for deterministic lockstep. So you can go through it and actually you can at least get an understanding about how it is. Kind of, and it uses deterministic lockstep, and it never transfers the position values to the other player. It just passes the inputs. Okay, so once the inputs are actually passed, actually there it actually simulates for you. So in this actually you can achieve the smooth simulation. You don't need to actually send all the states to the game state, because game state requires huge bandwidth. Okay, so this is one, even in old days, the Doom. Okay, so the Doom game, if you know, the first version was actually single player. Okay, how to make it actually, how he made it multiplayer, the ID software, it is ID software, and John Kalborg, how he made it as multiplayer is just by introducing deterministic lockstep of 32-bit integer. Okay, so because it's there, even if you think, keenly, any calculations yield the same output. So why can't we use that particular feature? Okay, so it is, the concept is already there, the determinism is already there. The only thing is actually you have to achieve it using certain techniques. Okay, so this is a floating point error. So what can cause a floating point error on different devices? So if you're using a same set of device, iOS, for example, iOS, it also generates the same amount of error. Okay, all the iOS device will have the same error, so there won't be any trouble. But different devices will have different kind of errors. So a slight increase or slight error, variation in error, can deviate the path of that particular bullet. So this is what's the biggest problem of this floating point error, and this is where actually determinism breaks. Okay, this is one problem. The other one is, like I said, actually fixing the time step. So the first equation, distance traveled is equal to bullet speed into delta time. If these two are constant, then definitely the distance traveled will also be a constant. Okay, that the first thing, the in the fixed time step, you can see all the frames, all the four frames are equally sized. That means the time interval is same. Okay, so the delta time is same, and the bullet speed, of course, if it is actually 100 meter per second or whatever is, then you will get distance traveled as the same output for all the frames. Okay, in variable time step, okay, since actually the frame took longer period of time, the second frame, so the delta time is going to get increased. So now let's say in frame 2 there is a wall over there, okay, and you calculate that particular distance traveled. You can see in frame 1 in both the fixed and variable, it is in same, starting from the same position, it is traveling, but in fixed time step, you are having the wall and it gets an overlap test, hit, but it misses this particular collision because of variable time step. This can be solved by using sweep test, but that's not the purpose of this particular slide, that in order to make you understand that actually fixed time step is very much important for physics. So that's why actually we people used to see that actually physics has to run in 60 FPS and kind of things. So after this one, we put the deterministic lockstep approach, and this is running under 100 ms. So definitely the deterministic lockstep will fail after certain latency. That means actually after 150 I started seeing the failure, but this is actually running under actually 100 to 120 ms latency. Okay, so the I think the left side is my device and the right one is the remote device, and you can see that clearly the physics is very smooth, even the positions are very smooth. I mean, it's very accurate. Okay, so this is what actually we can achieve by using deterministic lockstep. Yeah, there is some sort of code you have to write for this one. So one is actually fixed point, as I said, actually fixed point mathematics, and you have to write your own small physics solver that can be easily ported to Unity using Unity plugin. Okay, so if you write a small physics solver, I have written those things. So you can go to that particular link and see actually what it is written. So from here, actually, Guru will explain you the next slides.
So I completely urge you to kind of look at that code, like whatever Arun talked about and whatever we talked in the previous slides. All of that is not just theory. I mean, we've tried those things out and actually it is, the code is available. Obviously, it can become slightly different based on your use case, but it's going to be a good starting point for you to kind of have as a reference. Any questions, you can kind of leave it there or reach out to any of us. Just before we kind of end, I just wanted to reiterate the takeaways. So the solutions are going to be extremely contextual. It's not going to be that these are the things that you need to do. You need to do deterministic lockstep or you need to write a physics solver. It's just going to be based on how complex your game is and how much you need to fix your user experience. Couple of things that you will obviously not be able to get rid of these decisions are essentially the network, which we saw TCP, UDP and their trade-offs, the client server versus P2P sort of a decision that you need to do. We also saw the way we synchronize, right? The simplistic stuff that came out of the box was position sync, which gave us accurate locations but extremely flawed physics animations running on other device. We moved to state sync, which gave us awesome experience of physics across both the devices, and that actually worked for us in our use case, where you did not really want accurate position in the first version of the game. But if you want to build the final version of the game, then that you need both good physics and also accurate location. That's where we saw how to build in determinism. Deterministic lockstep is one, and then writing your own physics solver could be another option, though it gets complex. So that is that. And so just to break down the complexities in your head of any multiplayer game, I think this is what we found useful, but it might vary based on other use cases too. So typically a turn-based game, which is like something that you can imagine like a poker or any of those card games, you have one person playing, then another person playing, then another person playing. So this is a turn-based game and not all the people are actually acting simultaneously. You have a lesser complexity of problems. You do have some problems like network connections and stuff like that, but your complexities are still going to be controlled, so you should not try to over-engineer problems there. Then you have come with the state sync kind of a thing where it was the first version of our game, which is you're okay with locations not being accurate, but you want the animations to be running smoothly. Then comes real-time simulation games where you want both of these things to be accurate. We saw our ping pong game, or if you're trying to build something like a real-time football game where multiple people are actually using the same, kicking the same soccer ball, right? So that's where things will get really complex, and you need to start worrying about all of these things like physics determinism and like the thinking determinism and stuff like that. That's a wrap on our thing. We'll be open for questions. Would really appreciate if you guys give us feedback. You can just click on this QR code and give us feedback. And for any questions, definitely reach out to either of us. Both of our email IDs are here. Would really appreciate if you share your own learnings and we can share further more information with you guys.